time to make it like, well, makes the difference even smaller, right?
Okay, that's a very good point. The answer to your question is the following. I reasoned exactly like you, and I wanted to normalize them, to think of rows as probabilities, so to normalize them that they sum up to one. But guess what? The proof of convergence wouldn't go through. So what do you do then? Then you set for the next simplest thing, which is what you are saying is L1 norm equals to 1. This is L2 norm equals to 1. And with L2 norms, for God knows what reasons, right, the proof goes like a charm. And it's actually very pretty. Yes?
So can we take the trust worth as a vector?
Yes, eventually we will take both trusts and ranks as vectors. Yes?
But it has like only one dimension, right?
Trust, okay, so that depends how you aggregate them. You can aggregate the trust of writers is a single vector. Ranks, because it's two-dimensional, you can think of it as a matrix, right? But you can also linearize it by kind of flattening the matrix by concatenating the rows. Yes?
So for this equation, it's a little bit like we treat the each item i in L as a dimension. So it's like
Yes. That's exactly what's happening. And in fact, if you look at the proof of convergence, the search is a bit unusual. Usually the search is done along the gradient. Here it's done in a little bit funny way, which makes it, I think, nice. But that's exactly what you are saying is perfectly correct. So this is Cartesian product of spaces, where the dimension of each space is the number of elements on the list. Yes. Okay, so now, but we can unroll these because we know what TR is. So we will have sum over all R's that voted on Li, but the trust rank TR is what? It is sum of all ranks row Lj over all L and J such that R voted for Lj. Right? What is the trust of a guy? His trust is sum of the ranks of all items that he voted for over all lists, right, and all J's for so that he voted for J. This means he voted on list L for object J, and voila, he gets this credit, right? And here then, of course, will be exactly the same, square root 1 smaller or equal than J less than ML, and this here will become, just like here, it will be sum R voted Lj sum sum of all, I should use L and say K so that it's less confusing, so that R R on list L voted for K, and then here you have a row L K squared. Now this is happens when, you see, because you have two objects, you have rows and trustworthiness, which we try to determine simultaneously. So to simplify things, we eliminate the trustworthiness. And look what you got here. This is just like in the page rank. You want that the rank row, if you now represent row as a vector concatenating all ranks over all lists of all elements, you have that row is equal f of row, where f is this mapping. So this mapping is f of row. It simply says, you know, what is a row vector? Well, it looks like this. It's a row 1, 2, and so forth. And then it starts row 2, 1, row 2, 2, and so forth. So this will be for the list L1. This will be for the list L2 and so forth, right? So this means simply taking the projection exactly according to the dimension onto that dimension, right? And so this is again just like PageRank. It's a fixed point, right? PageRank, with the only difference that PageRank is linear. When you multiply a vector by a matrix consisting of numbers only, you get a linear combination of the coordinates. So it's a linear mapping. This mapping obviously is not linear just because of normalization. It would have been linear if it didn't normalize, but it wouldn't converge. So now we get this as a condition of row. But we still don't know how to compute it. And the proof of convergence tells you the following. You start, so how to compute the ranks and trustworthiness. So this is just, ignore, this is just to tell you that it reduces to a fixed point. But we will deal with both rows and trustworthiness. Okay, we will have both of them rather than eliminating trustworthiness because it's very simple. So how do we compute the ranks? And you know, this student of mine applied it to movie ratings, to all sorts of things, and it produced really pretty amazing results. You can read his paper. It's on the website. And as I say, you can use it for all sorts of things, for stocks and whatnot. So how do we compute this? We start by giving benefit of the doubt to each rater. Each rater will have equal credibility one. So we will start. So instead of TR, we will have a recursive procedure. We will start with zero iteration, where trustworthiness of each guy is one. Right? Now we compute the ranks with this trustworthiness. So rank of object I on list L at zero iteration will be, according to our formula, sum over all r's that voted for at least L on object I of tr divided by sum of square roots of all of these, but over objects, all objects j. Let me not write it because it will only look ugly. Right? What is this? What is this sum? What is sum of the r's of all r's that voted on list L for item I if all trustworthiness are equal to 1? What is this r equal to?
The number of the voters.
exactly, the number of voters that voted for this object. That's how we normally aggregate the votes. We simply total how many votes each candidate got. So this is equal to the cardinality of R, such that R voted on list L for object L. So this is just number of voters who voted on list L for item I. We have to normalize it. How? By dividing by the square root over all j's, depending on how many elements, items are on the list L, of the trust, which is the number of voters R that voted on list L for item J, R such that R voted for R such that R voted and then squared, right? So what is this? You simply count, right, for each item, you count how many people voted for that item. And then you normalize by some of the squares of these totals for every object J on the list. So this is the first iteration, basic iteration, starting iteration of trust, and LR, right? Now, since we have, okay, so now we are going to iterate, as simple as that. Because, so initially in the zeroth round of iteration, we gave benefit of the doubt to all voters. We consider them equally trustworthy and simply count the number of voters. Now you iterate as follows. Let's write another round. So what will be raw first iteration, sorry, the trustworthiness of R in iteration 1. Well, this will be sum of the ranks of all objects that over, so this will be sum over all lists and all objects such that R voted for Li of row Li 0. So now, not all objects have equal rank because not equal number of people voted for each item. So this is now next step of iteration. So now we are using rows from previous round, and now we can compute new row 1 of Li as sum of tr but of this round divided by square root over all objects j. And then here is sum tr, here it will be over r lj squared, right? And this is also first round. Now we can iterate again. We can now compute new trustworthiness. Now, what is the upshot here? Now, not all of them will have the same trustworthiness. Guys who voted for objects that had large number of voters voting for them will have large trustworthiness, right? So this will be raw, taking into account how the voters voted in the it's the same voting. We don't change, it's not that the voters vote again. It's a fixed voting, just the aggregation is iterative. So in general, we have TR N plus 1 is equal to the sum LI, R voted for LI, row LI obtained in the previous round, right? And then row LI N plus 1 will be equal to the sum of TR in the previous, in new trustworthiness, n plus 1 as computed, over square root over j of the same thing here, but for j. Right? And you keep iterating. And to explain the question of this lady, why didn't I choose that sum of the rows equal to 1? I couldn't prove that the thing converges. But with this quadratic L2 normalization, right, you will see later why it's called L2. This is Euclidean norm, right? L1 norm, what is L1 plus rho 2? If you think in several dimensions, it's Manhattan distance. If this is rho 1 and this is rho 2, rho 1 plus rho 2 is the Manhattan distance between these two points. So L1 distance between, so you have, L1 norm, this is so written like this, rho 1 is equal to first coordinate plus second coordinate, and if they can be negative, you have to put absolute values. On the other hand, rho 2 is equal square root of rho 1 squared plus rho 2 squared, which is just Euclidean norm, right? So this is Manhattan norm, and this is Euclidean norm. And one can prove that this converges. Sorry?
How to prove it?
Oh, well, how to prove it? I think, I mean, I tried 1 year and people had allergic reactions. They started going red in their faces and swollen, so I just... you have to read it in the... It's in the lecture notes, and there is also the paper. The proof is very beautiful, I have to say. It's very geometric.
Alex, like, I want to go back to the original equation.
Yes.
Because, like, we mentioned, like, P equals to F. So basically, like, the convergence will be achieved.
Yes.
So, like, can we argue that F will be the eigenvalue of the matrix?
Okay, you cannot call it eigenvalue because F is not linear. Eigenvalues are... when the mappings are linear and eigenvalue is 1, then the eigenvector, we call it eigenvector. In general, right, so in Google PageRank, you have linear equation. Here we have rho equals f of rho. And this rho, this f is no longer linear. This is called fixed point. Because what does F do to rho? It does nothing, it doesn't move it. Right? And in fact, it's relatively easy by using something called Brouwer fixed point theorem. to show that such row exists, but Brouwer fixed point theorem doesn't tell you how to find it. But the proof that is in the notes or in the paper shows that this iteration converges precisely to a fixed point. Okay, now let us be more concrete. We have 20 minutes to see how this works in practice, because I have a mathematical code for this. And the feature is that it's extraordinarily robust against collisions. Okay, so let's see what happens. Please install Mathematica. It's free for students, and once you start using it, look, if you ask me what's the derivative of sine, I don't know. Because Mathematica does all differentiation for me. It's like why I cannot spell, because my speller, spell check, how do you call it? Spell checker corrects my mistakes, and I don't bother to learn the proper spelling. So I have similar experience with Mathematica. I forgot how, if you ask me, if you threaten to kill me, I cannot integrate basic integral, because Mathematica does everything for me, and it's completely high level. You simply write formulas, and Mathematica essentially implements it and just gives you the answer. So, and play with the algorithm. Okay, so. As you can see, iterative algorithms, you will see in this course a huge number of iterative algorithms, not because I like them, but because they are used in industry. For example, the algorithm that I told you about power adjustment for your mobile phone is also an iterative algorithm. And iterative algorithms are, and also lots of stuff that you do with big data involves iterative algorithms. So,
the many bars have available.
house told you I don't see what you see, so okay. So here is the marvel of mathematics. No, no, that's not the one. Shoot. Probably this one. Okay, here it is. So what are we doing here? Okay. Here is first we want to, what is the aim? We want to show how robust against collusion it is. So we have to generate some kind of meaningful votes. How do we do that? Well, I define these few lists. How are they to be interpreted? You interpret it as follows, that when you get old, then you need all sorts of contraptions to function properly. So the lists are interpreted as follows, sorry, just one moment, I have to resize the output. This code is, I believe, on the web. I have to check on the class website. So I invite you to play with this, implement it in your favorite language, and think what you can do with it, right? Maybe you can get a creative idea for your final project. Okay, there we go. So the meaning of these lists is the following. The first honest voter voted according to the first column. So the first voter votes for candidate 1 on the first list, candidate 6 on the second list, candidate 5 on the third list, and candidate 8 to the fourth list, and so forth. Okay. So what we do now, we just to kind of ensure some consistency among voters, we simply replicate this for how many times? 5 times, no, how many times, how many? 3 times as many voters. So this would be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 voters. If you replicate it 3 times, it will be 15 voltages. And these are, so to speak, honest voltages. Now, what you can see is that on the list 7, who is the favorite candidate for honest voters? Who do they want to choose? So the columns tells you, so the rows are the lists, right? So the columns tells you, first column is how the first voter voted. Second column is how the second voter voted. Then third and so forth. But if you look at list 7, who is the preferred choice? One, the first candidate, right? So we will have 15 voters voting for that candidate. And this you can see on the matrix here. So how is this matrix obtained? I replicated the first, first, I believe, yes. So first 15 voters, they're the honest voters. And on the last list, they clearly, everyone thinks candidate one is the best. Now come, how many, 5 times as many malicious voters. What do malicious voters want to do? They want to subvert the election of person number 1, and they want to replace it by whom? Person number 5. And look how many of them there are. Where is the scroll bar? Here, why it doesn't show? Oh, well. Okay, so look, there are far many malicious voters, so we will have 31 minus 15, so that's, how this doesn't add up. So there are, this is 40, 50, 57, 58, 59, sorry, I'm almost blind, so I don't even see. So out of, so there are, my goodness, this is, oh, this is bloody Mathematica is wrapping when it goes over. So there are altogether, let's see how many, 41, 42, 43, 46, 47, 48. 49, 50, 51, 52, 53, 55, 56, what? You know, so it's it is a massive collusion. So 60, so you have 15 honest and 60 minus 15, that would be 45. 3 times as many colluders. But they only care of the outcome on the very last list. And they vote randomly for all other lists because they don't care. Okay? So you have 45 colluders voting for number 5, 15 honest voters voting for number 1. So if you aggregate this, this is what you get. So these are the scores. On the, you can see kind of distribution of votes. On the very last list, 15 voters for candidate 1 and 45 voters for candidate number 5. Okay? So this is the initial score. So now we give to this here, what you see is just implementation of this recurrence. You can see it here. This is just the normalization. This is the raw ranks and divided by the squares of the ranks. The only difference that I did not tell you is you want trustworthiness to take to a power alpha that is between 2 and 3. To make, because higher alpha, more robust the algorithm is. So the trustworthiness, you want to kind of amplify it by taking it to a square up to cube. This is a parameter, design parameter. Okay, so here is what you get as trustworthiness, as ranks. If you, when you normalize with some of the squares, the first voter gets only 0.31 rank. This voter gets 0.94. If you square these, right, this is 0.09 plus these squares, it's easy to see, it sums up to 1. And you see all the trustworthiness of all voters, initial trustworthiness at iteration 0. So this is the trustworthiness of nth voter at 0th stage of iteration. Now you run algorithm once, and what happens? Compare with this. This guy started with 0.31, 0.94. When you run the algorithm once, this becomes 0.38, this becomes 0.92. So this is slowly decaying, this is slowly increasing. You run it once again, this becomes, here it is, 0.46, this becomes 0.85. And as you run it until between two consecutive iterations, the difference of ratings of all candidates becomes smaller than 10 to the minus 4. This is when you claim the algorithm has converged. If you run it, this is what happens. At the end, the first candidate gets 0.97, the one that was pushed by malicious voter gets 0.23. So of course this guy wins. And notice what is remarkable about that is that the number of colluders is three times the number of the honest voters. But the point is that honest voters more or less have voted reasonably consistently, right? These guys vote randomly. So the probabilities that they will vote, that several people will vote as they vote, is much smaller.